Well, students, in this lecture, we are going to study about an important law in this chapter of X-rays. It's called as the Moseley's law. And Moseley's law is a law which applies only to characteristic X-ray spectra. Okay. Remember in the previous class that we saw that the X-rays which are emitted are of two types. They are characteristic X-rays and continuous X-rays. And we also saw the difference between the two. And this Moseley's law applies only to characteristic X-rays. So what it says is that the frequency of any spectral line in characteristic X-ray spectra is directly proportional to the square of the atomic number of the target element emitting it. So, what is the meaning of spectral line? These lines, no, this K alpha, K beta, K gamma line, or L alpha, L beta, and so on. These lines are called as spectral lines. So, what the law says is that the frequency of these lines, what does it depend upon? It's directly proportional to the square of the atomic number of the target element. So, for example, let us say we have the target we are using is copper. Copper has an atomic number of 29. So, what the Moseley's law says is that the frequency of these K alpha, K beta lines in this characteristic X-ray spectra will be directly proportional to 29 square, because the atomic number of copper is 29. Suppose you are using tungsten target. Tungsten has an atomic number of 74. Then the frequency of these K alpha lines, K beta lines coming from this tungsten target will be directly proportional to 74 square. So, frequency of the lines is directly proportional to the square of the atomic number. So, that is what the law says. In terms of the mathematical equation, so we can write it as nu is proportional to z square. It should have actually been nu is proportional to z square. Z is the atomic number. But later on, it was found out that there was a slight correction which was required for this. And the correction factor is A. So, it's actually not frequency is proportional to z square. It is frequency is proportional to z minus a the whole square. So, a is a correction factor. It's called as a nuclear screening constant. And a has a value equal to 1. For any of the k series lines, so for the k alpha, k beta, k gamma line, the value of a to be substituted in this formula is a is equal to 1. But remember, since a is a constant, this law that frequency is proportional to z square, atomic number square, still holds because a is a constant, it's not a variable. So, still, the law says, the law holds that frequency is proportional to z square. Okay. Now, since this is a proportionality, if you put an equal to sign, you have to put insert constant of proportionality and other things. So, putting all the constant of proportionality in it and all, we get the final equation formula of Moseley's law as 1 upon lambda. Now, this law is in terms of frequency, and here we are writing the formula in terms of 1 upon lambda. Remember, since frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other, we can replace in terms of proportionalities, we can replace frequency with 1 by lambda. So, this formula and this law basically represent the same thing. They are not two different things. Okay. So, 1 upon lambda is equal to R into Z minus A the whole square. So, this is there as it is because of the proportionality. So, Z minus A the whole square. And R and this factor here are the constant of proportionalities. Now, what is R here? R is a Rydberg's constant, has a value 1.097 into 10 raised to 7 per meter. And this thing 1 upon nf square minus 1 upon ni square, here nf and ni represent the, nf represents the final quantum number and ni represents the initial quantum number involving that line, k alpha line or k beta line. For example, for the k alpha line, we are writing a formula, special formula for the k alpha line, because I had told you out of all the lines k alpha, k beta, k gamma, l alpha and so on, the k alpha line is the most prominent line and most of the problems also come based on this formula, based on the k alpha line. So, for the k alpha line, let us write a formula for the wavelength, in 1 upon wavelength. If you remember for the k alpha line in this figure, for the k alpha line arises from a transition from L shell to the N shell. So, for L shell, the value of N is equal to 2. So, this is the initial quantum number Ni. It starts from here and it ends on here. So, Ni is 2 and Nf is 1. So, putting Nf as Ni as 2 and Nf as 1 in this Moseley's formula here, we'll see that it becomes 1 upon 1 square minus 1 upon 2 square. So, 1 upon 1 square is 1 minus 1 upon 2 square is 1 by 4. So, 1 minus 1 by 4 is 3 by 4. So, that's how we get this factor of 3 by 4. So, 3 by 4 R Z minus A, Z minus 1 the whole square. Because why 1? Because for any of the K lines, as I told you, for any of the K series lines, the value of A is 1. So, K alpha is a K line, K series line. So, the value of A is 1 here. So, the formula 1 upon lambda k alpha, this k alpha here is a subscript. So, it is 1 upon lambda k alpha is equal to 3 by 4 is this factor here. R is there as it is and z minus 1, z minus A the whole square. So, this is the formula, special formula for the k alpha line. So, you can use this formula for problems for determining the atomic number and other things. Okay, so problems come based on this formula mostly. So this is the Moseley's law. Now, what is the significance of Moseley's law? Okay, Moseley's law, the first important significance is that it helped in correcting the periodic table. Okay, if you remember, the periodic table which we currently use is the modern periodic table. Okay, modern periodic table. And what is the periodic table? In the periodic table, the elements are arranged in the respective groups. No? And each group, the elements in a particular group obey common properties. Okay, so that is what a periodic table is about. After a certain period, the property of that element repeats. So in a particular group, all the elements have the same properties. Now, in the Mendeleev's table, the elements were arranged according to their atomic weights, atomic mass, M, capital M. Whereas in the modern periodic table, elements are arranged as per their atomic number, okay, atomic number which is Z. So, if you take an example, okay, now, why was the correction in the Mendeleev's periodic table required? So, let's take an example, a prominent example of argon and potassium. Now, argon has atomic number 18 and potassium has atomic number 19. Argon has atomic mass 39.948 and potassium has atomic mass 39.098. So, if you see, in the Mendeleev's table, who came first was potassium because it was having a lesser atomic mass. Then came argon. So, in the Mendeleev's periodic table, here instead of argon was potassium, K. Whereas here in place of potassium was argon. So, they were interchanged. In the Mendeleev's table, this was argon and here was potassium, which was wrong obviously because potassium is an alkali metal. It should come here. Whereas argon is an inert gas. It should come here. In the Mendeleev's table, potassium was coming here, which was indicating that potassium is an inert gas, which is not. Whereas argon placed over here means that argon was supposed to be an alkali metal, which is not, right? So argon is an inert gas, it should come here. Potassium is an alkali metal, it should come here. So in the Mendeleev's periodic table, position of argon and potassium were in wrong places. So now, in the modern periodic table, how does it get corrected? Modern periodic table is based on atomic number. Increasing atomic number. Argon has a lesser atomic number. Potassium has a higher atomic number. So, argon came before potassium, which is as per this order. So, argon is placed here, lesser atomic number 18. And potassium, atomic number 19, came down below argon in the alkali metal position here, which is correct, obeying the proper respective group properties, alkali metals and inert gases. So, the modern periodic table, which is arranged as per the atomic numbers, is the correct version. It is to be as per the atomic numbers. So, who gave the hint? How did they arrive at this conclusion that elements should be arranged as per the atomic number and not as per atomic weights? They took a clue from, hint from the Moseley's law. Moseley's law says that frequency is proportional to atomic numbers, square of atomic number, not atomic mass. So, frequency is proportional to Z, not capital M. So, taking a hint from this, they said, okay, Mendeleev's periodic table, they were having problems, elements were deviating, especially argon and potassium. So, they said, let's try arranging elements as per the atomic number because Moseley's law says this frequency depends on atomic number. So, let's try arranging elements as per atomic number. And when they put them in increasing atomic number, they had a proper table there. The elements were falling in the proper place. Okay. So, the correction of Mendeleev's periodic table, the clue, the hint came from the Moseley's law, which says that frequency is proportional to the atomic number and not atomic mass, atomic weight. So, that was the first important significance of Moseley's law. It helped in correcting the periodic table. The second importance is that Moseley's law helped in determining the atomic number of unknown elements. Now, in the earlier times when new elements were being discovered, the question arises that where to place them in the periodic table. So, suppose I discovered a new element. Where do I put it in the periodic table? To put it in the periodic table, you have to know its atomic number. So, how do I determine atomic number? So, till atomic number is determined, you cannot put it in a particular place in the periodic table. So, new element which was discovered, first thing required was to determine atomic number. So, how was it done using Moseley's law? So, whatever new element they had discovered, they put it as a target. They used it as a target in the X-ray tube. Okay. And whatever X-rays, fast-moving electrons, when they struck this target, this new element, whatever X-rays came out, the K-alpha line, they measured the wavelength of the K-alpha line using a spectrometer. So the wavelength they measured of the K alpha line. So knowing the value of wavelength, Z could be calculated, because other things are all constant in this formula. R is a known value. So if lambda of the K alpha line could be measured, the value of Z could be found out. So once you know the value of Z, you can identify and place the element in the proper place in the periodic table. Okay, so Moseley's law helped in determining the atomic number and the unknown elements. They could be identified based on the Moseley's law using this formula. So lambda is found and Z could then be calculated. So this is the significance of Moseley's law: correction of periodic table and identification of new elements and determining their atomic numbers. Let's move on to properties of X-rays. This is a few properties. Already I have told you the first one. X-rays are electromagnetic waves having a wavelength around 1 angstrom unit. X-rays are invisible to the human eye. We cannot see them. And they travel in straight lines with the speed of light. Now, X-rays are invisible to the human eye. This has some important historic significance. Why X-rays called as X-rays? Why this funny name like X-rays, X? Now, remember, at the time when X-rays were discovered, people didn't know what they were. They were knew that there were some rays, something, but they were invisible. They could not be seen. So something very mysterious, unknown. So just like in mathematics, we use X for the something which is unknown, unknown number. So people also at that time when X-rays were initially discovered, they named them as X-rays, unknown rays. So that's how the name X-rays came into existence. And still today, even though today we know that they are electromagnetic waves, still today we call them as X-rays. Second property is that X-rays are not deflected by electric and magnetic fields, which shows that they do not have any charge. Only charged particles can be deflected by electric and magnetic fields. But when you pass X-rays through an electric field or a magnetic field, they pass right straight through them without any deflection. So that proves that X-rays do not have any charge. If they had charge, they would have got deflected by electric and magnetic field. Okay. Third property is that X-rays cause fluorescence in many substances like zinc sulfide, barium, cadmium, tungsten, etc. and can be detected using these substances. Now, what is the meaning of fluorescence? Whenever X-rays strike these materials, no, any of these materials, the place where the X-rays strike them, that place glows with a green color dot. Okay, a green color spot is produced wherever X-rays strike these materials. So remember, X-rays cannot be seen. They are invisible to the human eye. So how can we detect them? You cannot place your hand or you cannot directly see them with the eye. Okay, so how do we detect them? So if you place a screen of, let us say, zinc sulfide, you make a square size screen of zinc sulfide and place it in the path of X-rays, the point where the X-rays strike it, that place there will glow with a green color. So in this way, X-rays can be detected using any of these materials through the phenomenon of fluorescence, glowing effect, green color glowing effect when X-rays strike it. Next property, X-rays can, this we all know, X-rays can pass through many materials like wood, paper, flesh, metal sheets, thin metal sheets. Because why? X-rays have very high energy, so they can penetrate any of these materials, unlike visible light which cannot pass through these materials. X-rays can ionize a gas through which they pass. Now, since X-rays have very high energy, when the X-rays are passed through a gas, they transfer the energy to these gas atoms and it results in removal of electrons from the outer shells of these atoms. So when you remove electrons from the outer shell, what is remaining behind is an ion, positively charged ion. So when X-rays are passed through a gas, the atoms of the gas get ionized. So ions are created. Okay, this is a property which is used in the ionization chamber. It's a chamber, it is a device which is used for detection of X-rays. Okay, we'll be seeing that later on. So X-rays ionize the gas through which they pass. Next property, X-rays produce photoelectric effect. What is this photoelectric effect? When light falls on a metal, electrons are emitted from the surface of the metal. This phenomena is called photoelectric effect. So X-rays also exhibit this phenomena. So when X-rays are incident on certain materials, they result in removal of electrons from the metal. Because remember, X-rays are just like electromagnetic waves. They are also like light, visible light. Only thing is that they have higher energy. So since X-rays are also electromagnetic waves, just like since visible light produces photoelectric effect, X-rays also produce photoelectric effect in some metals. Okay, just like visible light. And last property, X-rays are harmful to human beings. Okay, harmful to living tissues. They can cause cancer. They can destroy red blood and white blood cells, and they can cause severe damage and to the organs of the human body. So, but remember, if you take an X-ray in a hospital, the next day you will not get cancer or you will not die. Because the amount of exposure which you get to X-rays in a hospital when you take an X-ray is very, very less. Okay. So, but prolonged exposure to X-rays, long-term exposure to X-rays can be harmful, can lead to cancer. Okay. So, these are some important properties of X-rays. Thank you.